Yeah.
right, judge number one, what do you feel?
I like that a lot. I like the flips. I thought one of you guys would smack your face and come pretty quick.
It was dreadful.
Wow. First step in the competition.
I snored.
Well done, a lot of energy. Definitely you're rocking with the flips, but off you go.
That's the ball, man.
Well, hey, look, I got PB&J.
Yeah, I really appreciated the
You guys win. You guys have fun. What? You're not going. Are you going? Not going and not going. We have four other captains go, right? All right, so I think last but not least, the wreck, Steph. In the name of James, in the worship. So here we go. Here we go. I'm going to give this to you.
So much. Give her your money.
Hi, y'all. I'm Pamela Pupkin. You're about to do Pamela Pupkin's Work After the Lord.
Thank you. Anyways, that's what I was saying. Raise your hand if you have been touched by God this week in a way that you've never been touched before. See, just imagine, you just had to come and surrender everything. Just imagine what could happen to your community if this place was jam-packed and chairs here and out the standing room only. You know what I mean? When they have a camp and they let you guys know about the dates and all that, oh, she's coming with authority. When you guys know the information and stuff, get people ready, tell them about it, invite them, pay for them. I don't even know what, just get them here. Sign their parents' signatures. I'm just kidding, don't do that. But I'm just kidding. But trust me, you're in high school, you've done it before. Sorry, I need to repent. I'm just kidding. Anyways, verdict. You may not. Yes.
Judges, come, do not leave me alone. I want to just piggyback over what
you said. Yeah, go, Mr.
Said.
Judge.
Guys, you know all of the fundraising that we did to get you here? You guys remember all that? When we're harassing you and blowing up your messages of being here for a car wash, being here for a garage sale, right now is why we do that, okay? So do you see how every hour and every effort was worth it? Yes? So when we start bugging you again, make sure you get signed up and get your way paid. All right, are we ready? Do we have a drum roll?
deep tonight. I believe God's going to do something big. So God is not done with you yet. Press in. Press in so deep. As we start singing these next songs at the worship tonight.
Come do what you want. Come. But I believe when I get to heaven, if I ask Jesus, why did you heal those other nine lepers? I'm just going to say, I can't help myself. I love them. I love them. I love them. I love them 100% right now, tonight. Guess what? Before you came to camp, when you were messing up and you weren't living for the Lord, He loved you 100% then. And when you do better after you leave camp and you start to grow in your relationship with God, He's going to love you the same then. He's not going to love you less if you do worse, and He's not going to love you more if you do better. And right now, I want you to know God loves you 100% right now. And there's some of you that you've been looking for love, and maybe you grew up not receiving the love in the way you should. Maybe you grew up in a home where you didn't receive love, and so now you're trying to look for love in other places, and probably because you're teenagers' relationships. And I remember when I was a kid, we didn't have a lot of money, and so I grew up drinking this thing called Tang. Have you ever had Tang?
Ourselves, a lot of you guys are there this weekend, and so I want to share a story with you.
and talk about the Holy Spirit for just a few minutes, and I'm going to read from John chapter 2, starting in verse 1. It says, on the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no more wine. Woman, why do you involve me? Okay, I'm going to suggest you don't say that to your mom, okay? This is Jesus. He's literally the only person who could ever say to his parents, I brought you into this world, and I will take you out, okay? So don't try that with your mom. Jesus replied, my hour had not yet come. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet. They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone bring out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink, but you have saved the best till now. What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. I want to talk to you about this story. It's the first miracle that Jesus did in his life when he turned water into wine. I want to pray first. And I want to say, tonight, it's just, I thank you for coming and your hunger to experience God tonight. I think you're going to experience God. And I just feel like God wanted me to get this word out, and I have to listen to the Holy Spirit, okay? So, Father, we just ask right now, Lord, for every person in this room, God, I pray their heart and their mind will be focused, Jesus, and we pray against any distractions or things that want to come against your word and what you want to do tonight, Lord. And I'm just asking right now, Father, for order in our hearts as we prepare to hear your word, God, that you would open up our hearts and our minds in Jesus' name. Amen. How many of you know Jesus is better than Taco Bell? Oh, yeah. He's better than fidget spinners. He's better than Takis and Hot Cheetos. Jesus is awesome. Some of you are realizing that for the first time this weekend. And I want you to know every single one of you here is called to be a game changer for Jesus Christ. You're called to be a game changer in this world. He created you. He doesn't create just ordinary people. He creates people on purpose with purpose, like we've said this weekend. But I want to tell you a story. I read an article about this game that happened between these two college basketball teams, Duke and Louisville. And at the halftime, Louisville and Duke, it was a very close game. And there was this player named Kevin Ware, and right before halftime, he went down. And he was injured. He was injured badly. And it's interesting that when he went down, he started yelling, win the game! Win the game! And the players, they went into halftime wondering what was going to happen with Kevin Ware because he had a terrible, terrible injury. In fact, his bone was actually protruding from his leg. It's terrible. It was terrible. I wouldn't show a picture. Do you want to see a picture of that?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It's you, Cam. Oh, shoot. I didn't know you were going to do that. All right. That's cool. That's the picture. But you know what it reminds me of is this second one. If you're a Disney fan, you know. That's sick. But hey, anyways, it has nothing to do with my sermon. No, I'm kidding. Listen. What happened was his team came out right after halftime, and they were on a different level. They won the game by 22 points, and going into half, it was a very close game. And when I read this article, the author actually called this a game-changing moment when Kevin Ware went down. It was a game-changing moment. It changed everything. And I want you to know tonight, God has sent his spirit to us to make you a game-changer. Every single one of you, no excuses. I can't speak. I can't do this. I can't sing. Because guess what? God doesn't call us all to speak or sing. He calls us to use what he put in us for his kingdom. But there's no excuses. He doesn't create people without purpose and destiny. You need to know tonight also, without the Holy Spirit, you're missing something that God wants to give you. You ever done a puzzle and like got to the end and there's like one piece missing and you're like, oh my gosh, like that will drive me crazy. I just did like a 5,000 piece puzzle and there's one piece
like right in the middle that's missing, oh, that will drive me nuts. Also, I've had it happen before where we took a youth trip to California, and we got to California, and I was so busy making sure all the youth luggage was loaded that I forgot my luggage in my car at the church. I did buy a new wardrobe, so there was a silver lining, praise God. But, or how about this? Maybe you've been here, and some of you are younger, you probably haven't dieted yet, but I'll pull into McDonald's on a diet, you know? And I think I'm going to get a salad. And then I get up to the front, and I'm like, Big Mac and large fries, let's go. And then something happens sometimes, and I'm sure it's happened to you before, where you get it to go, you go home, you're so excited for your Big Mac and fries, and you open the bag, and there's no fries. You ever had that happen? Oh my gosh. Now there's two types of people in the world. There's people that will get back in their car, drive back to McDonald's and say, where are my fries? And then how many of those are you tonight? Who would do that?
That's my mom.
I'd probably do it too, I'm gonna be honest. And there's other people who just say, it's fine, I'll just eat the Big Mac and have an apple or something. No, I ordered those fries. I paid for those fries. I'll get those fries. But there's something missing. And in your life, God sent the Holy Spirit to be your helper. And without it, that means you are missing out on something that God desired for you to have. And it all starts by just saying, God, I want everything that you have for me. I'm not one to get up here and say, this is what it's going to look like, this is how it's going to feel. So I'm just saying, I would just ask you right now, as we start tonight, and as you hear his word, we're going to go back into worship in a few minutes, and I want to ask you right now, just in your heart, just say, Holy Spirit, I'm open to whatever you want to do. Because guess what? There's a fear sometimes that people feel with that because they don't know what it's going to look like or how it's going to feel. But I promise you, anything that Jesus wants to give you is good. Because remember what I said, he loves you. And so you might have seen things you don't understand, and there's kind of like an anxiousness, like, I don't know what that is. And I promise you, anything that God wants to give you is good. So right now, I just ask, Jesus, we open up our hearts to you, God. And you said, if we ask for the Holy Spirit, that you would give it to us. And right now, Lord, I believe young people in this room are opening up their hearts and saying, Holy Spirit, would you come and do a work in my heart and bring healing and also fill me up with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So who is the Spirit? There's a few things I want to tell you. If you're taking notes, by the way, you should take notes when you're in church, because note takers are world changers or game changers. The number one thing I want you to write down is, he is our mark of belonging. He is our mark of belonging. Also, statistics show those who take notes in church are 95% more likely to make it to heaven. So, no, I'm just kidding. That's just me. But do it. You'll remember what you're reading. And guess what? God may give you a word tonight or this Sunday when you go to church, because you're all going to be in there next Sunday when you get back, or this Wednesday or Thursday, whatever you do. And he's going to give you maybe a word, and you won't need it right now, but later on, you can say, wait a second, I'm dealing with worry. And I remember months ago, I heard Pastor Graham talk about worry. I took notes. I'm going to pull it out, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit can speak to me in the timing that I need it. All because I wrote it down. You're not going to remember everything, so you need to write things down. Have you ever met an American citizen who just received their citizenship? Like, they're from another country, but they've already taken the test and they're now an American citizen, and they know more about the U.S. presidents and the Constitution than you do, but they're an American citizen. You might talk to this person, and honestly, they don't really seem like an American. I mean, you're like, hey, you want to come over and watch some football? We'll have some pizza. And they're like, oh, you mean football, like soccer? And you're like, no, dude. This is America. We don't play soccer. I'm just kidding. Don't get offended, Bobby. and so we don't understand, but in that moment that they took their test, they gained their citizenship, and they're right now instantly a citizen. But it takes them a while to actually begin to act like an American, which might not be a great thing. I don't know. But after a while, you go back out to their house, and you're like, Matt, do you want to watch the football and get a pizza? Like, yeah, what do you want? Pepperoni? Pineapple? Pineapple doesn't belong on pizza. But let's get some candy. Because it takes them a while to act like a citizen. But in the moment that they sign that paper, their citizenship was said and done. And in the moment that you give your life to Jesus, your citizenship in heaven is said and done. But you're going to go home, and the enemy is going to come in like a flood. He's going to try and get you to turn back. There's going to be a little voice when you get home that says, come back. up from time to time, the enemy's going to tell you your citizenship is not for sure, and God doesn't love you because you're not good enough. But I need you to know tonight, your citizenship is sure. You were adopted into the kingdom of God the moment you gave your life to Him. And it's through the mark of belonging, through the Holy Spirit, that He's changing you from the inside out. Yes, you're going to go home and there might be some things that fall off of your life, and it's awesome. When God does the instantaneous, we love that. I love to see God just change your life instantaneously, but a lot of times in my life, my experience is He's slowly refining me and changing me by speaking to my heart. So how do we walk this thing out? How do I act more like Christ? How is the Holy Spirit going to change me from the inside out? Sometimes we approach Christianity, and if you've never experienced God and you've just grown up in church, you may have thought of Christianity before you encountered Him this weekend as just like a rule book with like 52,000 things that you can't do. As soon as you walk into church, you're like, here you go, here's your brochure. There's 52,000 things you can't do anymore. That is not Christianity at all. But that's how it's presented sometimes. Christianity and a relationship with God is a place that you can come before you belong. I'm sorry. You can come before you become. Meaning, you can come to Jesus and you can come to church and you might not act like or look like other people who've been walking with Jesus for very long, but in the instant that you gave your life to Jesus, you are now, your citizenship is sure in the kingdom of God. And then as you come, and as you allow the mark of belonging, the Holy Spirit to change you, you will become more like Christ. And that's what the Holy Spirit's job is. He is to come in and transform you into the image of God. Transform you into acting more like Christ. And the thing is, if you say you love Jesus, but you still love sin, then you need to ask yourself, do I have the mark? Because something that follows the Holy Spirit in your life is conviction. Meaning, if you have a relationship with Jesus and you have the Holy Spirit living in you, then you will not enjoy sin like you used to. Brent, I had an encounter with God. Guess what? I need you to know this before you go home. Encounter with God brings change. Brent, I hear it all the time. Brent, I had an encounter with God at youth camp. That is awesome. I'm so glad. But why are you still disrespecting your parents if you had an encounter with God? It's getting quiet in here. I understand why. But I encountered God, Brent. I did. Well, then why are you still gossiping about people that think that they're your friends behind their back? Why are you still chasing after love from a boy or a girl when God has promised you that He'll bring you somebody and He has a plan for your life if you just trust Him instead of trying to go and find the one? You should be working on becoming the one that the one you're looking for is looking for. And so, did that make sense? Was that too mouthful? Try saying that three times fast. I said, instead of trying to find the one, how about trying to become the one you're looking for is looking for? Because I hear a lot of young teenage Christian boys and girls who say things like, I'm going to find a good man who loves Jesus and reads his Bible. He's going to be a preacher, or she's going to be a worship leader. And honestly, I look at them and I say, okay, but who are you? Are they going to want you? Let's be honest with ourselves. If we spend less time looking for that person and spend more time looking in here and say, God, change me, then when that person comes along, here, let me give you a little lesson. Here's how you tell if you're equally yoked with somebody, okay? If you're running as fast as you can towards Jesus and they're running the same pace as you, you might be equally yoked. Wait a second. That means you can both love Jesus, but you are just running a completely different race at a faster pace than somebody. But they still love Jesus, but they are not running as fast as you are. And they're not living it out the way you are. You are unequally yoked. Wow. Here's what you need to do. You need to run as fast as you can towards Jesus. Then next thing you know, maybe you look over and there's a cute girl running next to you. All right, that's cool. I'm just running towards Jesus. Keep running towards Jesus. Keep running towards Jesus. You look over. Hey, maybe they're still there. Hey, that's nice to meet you. Yeah, and you keep running towards Jesus. And sooner or later, in God's timing and plan, guess what? 2% of high school relationships end up in marriage. 2%. Don't even get me started on middle school relationships, which I had. I'm not saying I didn't. But let's be honest, if we spent less time looking around for the one and spent more time looking towards the one, Jesus Christ, we wouldn't have half the issues and drama you have in your life. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Number two, the second thing I want to tell you about the Holy Spirit is he's your guide on the journey. Sometimes we begin a relationship with God, you say, okay, I'm a child of God, that's it, now I'm going to heaven. Praise God. Hey, what do you want to do? Let's go do whatever. No, that's not it. The Holy Spirit is who God sent to be your helper, and he's also called the comforter, meaning he wants to walk with you every day. And I think I talked about this if you were at the service at Mingus a few weeks ago, but I like to relate it to Disney. I relate everything to Disney movies. You won't, I'm not going to sing any Disney movies tonight. But in the movie, this doesn't even apply. I don't know any songs from this movie. In the movie Tangled, do you remember the movie Tangled? Come on. Disney will preach, let me tell you what. But Rapunzel, she lived her life in poverty. She was stolen at a young age, and she didn't even know it, but she was a princess who was kidnapped. Her whole life she lived in poverty, didn't know this. And then as she got to a certain age, she found out that she was a princess. And do you think that she walked into that castle the next day and knew exactly how to walk like a princess? I don't think so. She probably had to have somebody walk with her and say, princesses don't eat with their fingers, okay? They eat with silverware. And we don't walk like that. We walk like this, and we don't talk like that. We talk like this. That is exactly what the Holy Spirit wants to do in your life. He is the guide on your journey. There's certain things that I used to do that now I would try. After I give my life to Jesus, he's still doing it to me. Let me tell you right now, it doesn't stop, and I thank him for it. But I'll be walking and doing something, and there's something inside of me that says, that's not you anymore. And you're going to go home from this weekend, and you're going to do some things, and the Holy Spirit is going to speak to you that you used to enjoy. You didn't think anything about it. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit is going to say, that's not quite right, what you did there. And you have a choice whether you want to respond to the Holy Spirit. But someone needs to walk with you daily. That's why the Holy Spirit was sent for you to be your guide on the journey. And the Holy Spirit doesn't just shout at you and make you feel bad. The Holy Spirit kind of nudges your heart and says, hey, why did you do that? That's not really you. And he doesn't tear you down. And he doesn't put condemnation on you. He leads by speaking to your heart. Do you know attacking people's actions will never change their behavior? Because this is not even about behavior modification. Christianity is not about behavior modification. It's about heart transformation. And when my heart is transformed, my behavior will change as a result. But too many Christians walk around trying to change their behavior every step of the way. I just got to change it. I got to change it. And then they just look constipated. Like, are you okay? You're not a Christian. I got to change my behavior. And it won't happen until Jesus changes your heart and there's something in you that says, that's not my son. That's not my daughter. I remember when I was a kid, I'm telling you right now, before I tell you the story, I'm in therapy and you're about to know why. I'm just kidding. I'm not in therapy. Just Jesus therapy. But I was out with my friends and we were causing trouble and I was a kid. I was a little kid and we used to play outside. I don't know if you've ever heard of this, but like... We actually went outside and played, and it was before Xbox, you know. And so we got bored, and we used to have things that were sold more easily than they are now. And we had firecrackers, and we had these things called M80s, which are like little dynamites. And we decided it'd be a good idea to go down my street and put one in a mailbox and watch the mailbox blow up. And so we did it, and we were like, yeah, okay, this is awesome. And then all of a sudden we saw these lights coming from down the street, these blue and red lights. And I'm telling you, I was like 9 or 10 years old. I took off running like I was on Cops, okay? And I started running. And then I heard this police officer get out of his car and he yelled, stop. And in that moment, a 10-year-old me thought I was about to get shot, okay? I remember I stopped, my friend stopped, we walked over to the officer and it may or may not have like a Mountain Dew type substance leaking down my leg. I don't remember for sure. But he said, you know what, you shouldn't have been doing that. He gave us, basically, we had to go to the homeowner, talk to them, and pay for it. But then I walked home after that, and you know what I saw in my front driveway? I saw my dad standing there. And, no, it gets better. My dad was laughing his head off. And he said, hey, what did the cops say? And I told him, and he said, you know what's funny? And I said, what is funny about this, Dad? He said, I called the cops. it struck something in me. He looked me in the eye and he said, you know, all joking around aside, that boy out there that did those things, he said, that's not my son. And you know what he did? He spoke to destiny in me. He didn't speak to who I was. Because if he spoke to who I was and said, what are you, dumb? Then I would have stayed that way. But he spoke to my destiny. He said, that is not who you are going to become. And all of a sudden, something in me rose up that said, I am made for more than I am living now. And that's what the Holy Spirit does in your life. There's something in you that says, I am made for more than I'm living right now. And he guides you on the journey as he speaks lovingly to your heart, brings you into your destiny. He guides you in three ways: by revealing truth in the Word to us, by bringing you into situations and relationships to help you grow, which, by the way, is why you are here right now. He brought you into this situation as a divine setup, and he brought you into relationships with the people that invited you to church camp or paid for you to go to church camp just so you can get in God's presence. This is all a setup, and he brought you here so that he can be a guide on your journey, because right now he wants to intervene in your story and say, wait a second. I love you too much to watch you go down this road. And sometimes he allows us to get in his presence and he guides us so we can have a detour in our life. And the third way that he guides you on your journey is through new thoughts and emotions. You know, when I was first married, I had a hard time apologizing. I'm going to be honest with you. And now, I've been married almost 15 years in like a month. Wow, that's crazy. 15 years in a month, and I apologize so quick now. Like, it's easy for me. You know why? Because over the years, the Holy Spirit has spoken to me. Every time I go to God, I say, this person, my wife, I can't believe. You know what God does? He says, no, Brent, you. And he's guided me. And now he's changed me. And I can say, I'm sorry very easily. And it doesn't cause the same strife as it used to. But if you want your faith to endure, then right now, tonight, you need to submit yourself to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. The Holy Spirit is not just going to lead you only to church services where you can encounter God. The Holy Spirit might lead you to a wilderness sometime. Yeah. You see, Jesus was baptized. The very next place that the Holy Spirit led him was right into the wilderness. That's not fun. And we all want to be filled with the Spirit, but sometimes we despise His correction. We all want the Spirit to come upon us, but do we want to be led by the Spirit? We want His power, but we don't want His correction. The third thing that the Holy Spirit is to us is He's our enabler. The Holy Spirit empowers us. I could not be up here talking to you without the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to explain a little bit about my testimony in a minute, but you need to know tonight that it's time to stop underestimating the power of what God wants to put on the inside of you. Some of you think, you know, I don't know what it looks like. You keep talking about a calling and a purpose. I don't have any gifts. I don't understand. I don't have the courage to do anything. But when the Holy Spirit empowers you, let's look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Power to what? To be a witness. I know it might not look like it now, but when I was your age, I was terrified of public speaking. In fact, I remember being in Pastor Greg's youth group, and I remember sitting in the back, and there was a time during some services where he'd say, you know what, get in little groups and pray for one another. And I remember something inside of me, like, tightened up, and I was terrified, like, I have to pray out loud. And you guys were awesome this morning praying out loud like that, man. But I'm telling you, that is not me naturally, but when the Holy Spirit came upon me, He gave me the power to do something that I was terrified of. Courage is not the absence of fear, it's actually having boldness in the face of fear. Every time I come up to speak, there's a nervousness on the inside of me, but you know what? I never let it stop me from doing what God has called me to do. And you need to know God wants to empower you through the Holy Spirit to do what He's called you to do. He wants to build your faith muscles. And what I mean by that is look at Jude verse 20. It says, but you, dear friends, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit. He says, there's something about praying in the Holy Spirit that builds you up. It's like there's faith that rises up on you when you can pray in the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you and you don't know what to pray, He'll pray for you, the Bible says. And so there's this power and this boldness that comes on you when the Holy Spirit comes on you. I want to tell you just a couple points from that story we read in John, just to tie this all together, and then we're going to worship. And I believe God is going to touch many of you, and I believe a lot of you are going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I think some of you have had a taste of what that looks like, but I think God is just ready to pour out everything that He has for you tonight. The first thing I want to talk to you about from that John chapter 2, where Jesus turned water into wine, is that God uses ordinary things and people. This is Jesus' first miracle. He's at a wedding, and you need to know in this culture, weddings lasted 7 days. And this is the first day, and they run out of wine. Okay, someone didn't plan correctly for this. And this is actually a shame that would be brought on the family, like, you didn't have enough wine for your wedding? Can you imagine a week-long wedding? Like, seriously, man, this is my wedding week. What? A week? Who has that kind of time to go and go to someone's wedding for 7 days? But the wedding ran out, and it was an embarrassment. And Jesus, He turns water into wine, and He doesn't use just any water. He gets water from these water pots. And these water pots were, you need to know, they were used for ceremonial cleansing. Which means that people who came into the wedding, they go over to these water pots and they wash off the dirt off their hands, and they wash off the who knows what on their feet. Okay, they didn't have cement. They had like horses and animals all in the streets, and they're walking in the dirt, and they wash their hands and their feet in this thing. I mean, I wouldn't do it. A teenage boy cleaning their feet in there, you need to cast a demon out of some of your feet. Let's just say that tonight at the altar, if you need your feet prayed for, because they stink. Some of you counselors, can I get an amen? Amen. This week after you've been in the room with them. But it was just water, not just that, it was filthy water. There's nothing special about water. No one like sniffs water like it's wine and goes, is that a Walmart special? They don't swish it around in their mouth and go, that's good water. They don't do it. In fact, it doesn't come in good containers. I had a water until I dropped it. But it comes in just a typical, you know how much this bottle costs? This is actually a decent one. I can barely squeeze it. But this is ordinary. It's cheap. I can get a case of these for like $3. And I need you to know tonight, God is looking for some people who are ordinary and feel unspecial to fill with His Spirit. Those are the ones He wants to use. I believe with all my heart, if I had thought I had everything I needed and I could do it on my own, I would not be standing here with you today, because God would not get the glory. But because you feel ordinary and ill-equipped, God is saying, that's the one I want to pour my Spirit out on.
Yes, sir.
That's the one I want to use for my glory, the ordinary one. So what do you need to do? What do you need? What do I need to do, Brent, to get filled with the Holy Spirit? You just need to be clean and you need to be empty. You just need to say, Jesus, forgive my sins and cleanse me and become His son, and you need to be empty, because it's hard to ask someone to come sit in the seat if I'm already filling it, isn't it? Hey, come fill this place. Actually, it's already full, so do you have another seat? Because I don't want to sit on your lap, Brent. That's weird. But often we do that with God. God, come fill me. How can I? You're already full of pride. And you haven't emptied yourself of that yet. God, come fill me. How can I? You're already full of yourself, or you're already full of this regret, or you're already full of sin in your life. How can I fill that place, whatever it is that you have used to fill that place in your heart? If you want to ask God to come and fill that place, you need to first empty yourself. Say, God, I'm emptying myself. I'm asking you to cleanse me. And Lord, I lay aside every insecurity that's filled that place. That every time someone talks about me, or every time I look in the mirror, I feel insecure. God, I'm setting that aside. I'm emptying that place and saying, God, I want to know what you say about me. Will you sit in this seat? Will you fill this place? And if you're clean and empty and you're willing, God will fill you. You know, I think one of the greatest tragedies in our culture is that after like grade school, there's no more recess. Can I just be honest with you tonight? And when we used to have recess, we used to play like real games.
I mean, we used to play kickball, we played tetherball, and then now I don't even get recess. I think they should have recess at work. Well, we don't even get it, but it was always funny when it came time to pick teams. Because everybody would line up, you know, and they'd pick a couple captains, and the captains would say, I want that guy, or I want that guy. And there's always the person who's like last pick. You've been that person.
Yeah.
And you're like, it's cool. I don't want to, I'll play next. I got next one. I want to stretch. I got to stretch anyways. You guys, it's cool. And I just know that every time someone was picked for a team, they were always picked on three things. They were picked on past performance, current form, and present pursuit. How bad do you want it? How did you do last week? How are you looking? Are you sick? You look a little tired today. I don't know. And we use these ways to just see if someone's desirable to have on our team. I need you to know tonight, God does not choose people that way. He's never chose people that way. Look at the scripture. Many of the people that he used would not have been used if he chose people based on past performance, current pursuit, and current form. You see, people like Gideon, who was hiding from the enemy, he didn't come to Gideon and say, how many battles have you won? Hey, fisherman, before I ask you to follow me, how many scriptures do you know? Hey, Peter, before I make you the leader of the church, I'm going to need you. I need you. Have you ever cussed, Peter? And I think a lot of times we look at ourselves and we think God uses us based on our past mistakes or based on who I am currently. But you, if you're going to remember anything tonight from this message, I want you to remember that God does not call the qualified. He qualifies those that he calls. So the fact that you feel ill and qualified tonight to do anything for God, that's okay. Guess what? That's a divine setup, and you're right where God wants you. The second thing that I take from the story is they're told to fill the pots to the brim. Amen. Fill it all the way to the top. You ever been to a restaurant and you get that overly eager like guy to come and refill your drink? And like he's like, I'm really good at my job. I'm gonna fill your drink all the way up. Like it's over the top. Like it's, you don't know how it's not dripping out. You can't pick it up. You gotta like lean over the table, and you're like, that's how much Jesus wants to fill you. Jesus wants to fill you up to the brim. And some of you like a little bit of Jesus. Fill me up this much, but I still need some things in the world to satisfy me. Jesus, fill me up this much, but I still got to go to that party Friday night to get a little more filled up. But guess what? That ain't going to fill you up. It's going to put you right back down in your mess. Or Jesus, I want to be full of you, but I need a text back from that person to feel full. Or I need enough likes on Instagram where I feel good about myself. Jesus wants to fill you up so much that you don't need any compliments. You don't even need an I'm sorry. You just need to say, Holy Spirit, come and fill me all the way up. It doesn't matter how many likes I get on Instagram. It doesn't matter who talks about me because I'm already chosen and accepted by you. It doesn't matter any of that stuff because I'm so full of the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir.
The third thing I want to tell you from the story of John is this water was for external use only. They didn't drink, this water. But Jesus wanted to take what they used on the outside and get it on the inside of them. And maybe some of you last night, you felt the presence of God. But I believe Jesus is saying to some of you tonight, I want to get the Holy Spirit down on the inside of you and fill you all the way to the brim. So that you can walk with this guide on the journey. You can walk with this mark of belonging. The fourth thing, almost done. A good wine takes years to ferment. And I believe God is telling us in the story, he wants to do something that should take years in moments with him. You're going to go home and your parents and the people around you are going to say, how did this happen? How are you doing these things? How did you change this much? How are you? You're too young to do this, which guess what? God loves using teenagers. Just read the scripture and see. He does not need you to wait. But how does this happen? And all you're going to be able to say is, God did it. God did it in moments what should have taken years. You may think you have to wait years to be used by God, but he wants to use you tomorrow. He wants to use you Monday at school. It tells, Jesus tells them, I want you to draw it out now. I want you to draw it out now. Jesus doesn't say, wait a little while, wait till you get a little older, and then I want to use you. He's saying, I want to do it now. The momentum that you built at this camp, God wants to use it for his purpose. I see this camp as like a bow and arrow, and he's pulling you back, and he's getting ready to fire. And you can go home, and you can use this momentum to do something awesome for God, or you can lose this momentum. You ever swam in an above-ground pool? Well, I grew up with a kid down my street, and we used to always do this thing, where we would walk in one direction around the pool. You ever done this? And we would walk, there'd be a bunch of us, and we'd see how fast we'd get that water moving. And you know, we built all this momentum, so much momentum that you know what would happen? Is we would lift up our feet, and we'd be like, dude, I'm still moving. But if I stopped moving and I just tried to coast, you know what happened? I would come to a stop. And that's going to happen to some of you. Unless you say, God, what you've done here, I'm going to keep moving. God, when I get home, I'm going to read my word. When I get home, I'm going to change some things. God's saying to somebody tonight, you need to delete your backup plan right now in your phone. There's that phone number of that person to call to do that thing you shouldn't be doing. And God is saying right now, you need to pull out your phone and delete some numbers because there is no backup plan. When I get home, I'm going to change some things and some people that are going to drag me down. I want to be a light, but there's a time where maybe I need to step back from some people. And this momentum will carry your city to change. It will carry your school, your family, your friends will be impacted by the momentum that God has started here. There's a purpose for it, but the miracle is in the drawing out. And God is saying to someone, draw it out now. Don't wait. As soon as you get home, as soon as you get out of service tonight, draw it out now on Facebook, on Instagram, on Snapchat. Draw it out now. Call somebody and say, God, change my life, and he's going to change yours, and I'm not going to stop until he does. I'm praying for you. Draw it out now. You don't have to wait. The Holy Spirit wants to fill you so that he can draw it out. He wants what's in you to get into someone else. It's never actually about you, the blessing that you receive. God told Abraham, I'm going to give you a son. I'm going to bless you. And why? So that you can be a blessing to all nations. And God, tonight, has started something in your life, but you cannot be a closed container. God wants to draw out what he's put in you this weekend, and it's not over yet. He's about to do a deposit to fill you to the brim. But we have too many closed containers in the church. Can I just be real tonight and honest and just say, we need to pop some bottles in the church and say, you know what God put in me? I'm going to pour it out on my friends. I'm going to pour it out on my family. And I don't care what it looks like, because I know God is with me and he's guiding me and he's going to empower me through his Holy Spirit. Will you stand up to your God, I'm not going to fake it.
I've seen other people, you know, fall down and stuff like that. Church, I'm not gonna fake it. You know what happened? He said God is gonna use you for his purpose and he's gonna empower you by his Holy Spirit. And he started praying for me, and I'm telling you, I don't know what happened, but I was on the ground. And then, you know what I thought in that moment? I thought, I'm so glad I didn't stop. I'm so glad I didn't let fear stop me from receiving everything God has for me. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I feel your presence in this place, Jesus. Yeah. Lord, I feel that young lady in this place, I feel like you're saying that she doesn't know who she is. She doesn't know the impact that she's going to have on the community around her. She's thinking right now, this is not for me. But God, there's a seed on the inside of her that you're beginning to water this weekend, and it's going to grow, and the faith in her life is going to begin to grow, and the Holy Spirit's going to guide her and help her to go on this journey that you have for her, and she's going to be used mightily for you. But it all starts by just saying, God, I'm willing and I'm clean. Father, right now, I just ask that you would forgive every young person in this room. Right now, just in your heart or in your own words out loud, just pray and say, Jesus, I need you to forgive me. God, I've made mistakes and I've done things in my life that have made me unclean, God. And right now, by the blood of Jesus, we just claim forgiveness over their life and salvation in Jesus' name, Lord. We believe that their sin now is behind them, God, and you don't see their sin when you look at them, but you see your Son, Jesus Christ. This is your Son and your daughters in this place, God. And Lord, they're clean, and I believe there's a young person right now who says, I'm willing, and I'm not going to let fear stop me. And in just a minute, I'm going to count to three, and on three, if you have the boldness to just say, Jesus, I don't know what it looks like, I don't know what it is, but if it's real, I want it, I want everything that you have for me. I want to invite you up on the count of three. Maybe some of you, before you've encountered God, you've already been filled with the Spirit, but I want to ask you to come as well and just say, Jesus, I need a refreshing. going to ask you right now that we're at this place where you're thinking at, you know what, I prayed for a while and I feel God's presence and some stuff happens, but some of you, there's a breakthrough that will take place and it rests on desperation. Because God, He doesn't respond to a need, He responds to desperation and He responds to prayer. And right now, Jesus, I'm just asking for the young people here who just feel a resistance, God, to pressing through. We just ask right now, Lord, your Holy Spirit would just come and flood that, God, and we just speak peace over them right now, Lord. Every distraction right now, in Jesus' name, you have to go. This moment is about you, and we're not leaving with less than we came for. We came for it all, Jesus. Will you tell them right now?